Good afternoon, and welcome to this important conversation on trust in institutions. As is Academy tradition, it is my pleasure to formally call to order the 2110th stated meeting of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. Today's event has the distinction of being a Morton L. Mandel conversation. Our late friend Mort Mandel had a keen appreciation for the power of dialogue and the necessity of robust political public institutions. His generosity enables us to be here to address distrust, polarization, and institutional efficacy, topics central to the Jack, Joseph, and Morton Mandel Foundation's mission. We are grateful for their continued support. Our conversation today will center around ideas advanced in the most recent issue of Daedalus, the quarterly journal of the American Academy. Daedalus was first published in 1955 and has tackled a prodigious breadth of topics over the past 68 years, everything from climate change to artificial intelligence to American music and jazz. Each issue of Daedalus, no matter the focus, is distinguished by its rigor, authority, and contribution of new knowledge. In January 2021, the Academy and our publisher, the MIT Press, announced that the journal would be moving to open access. In the 2 years since, Daedalus has seen a significant increase in online readership, downloaded essays, and citations. We are proud of this investment in making Daedalus content, both past and future, available to as wide an audience as possible. It is our belief that increasing access to knowledge can play a constructive role in increasing public trust in information and in institutions themselves. Repairing the erosion of trust in institutions is an essential task that stretches across all Academy endeavors. From the work of our Commission on the Practice of Democratic Citizenship to recent projects on public trust in vaccines and the public face of science to our ongoing Commission on Accelerating Climate Action, and now this most recent Daedalus issue, addressing the polarization of trust has been a major Academy priority and will remain so going forward. The fall 2022 issue of Daedalus on Institutions, Experts, and the Loss of Trust was made possible in part by a generous gift from the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation. We are grateful to Knight Foundation President and Academy member Alberto Ibarguen for his support of this volume and his many contributions to the work of the Academy. We are also grateful to our guest editors, Henry E. Brady, the class of 1941 Monroe Deutsch Professor of Political Science and Public Policy at the University of California, Berkeley, and Kay Lehman Schlozman, the J. Joseph Moakley Endowed Professor in Political Science at Boston College, for their leadership and vision on the volume. If you haven't yet, I encourage you to spend time with the issue following this program. We are proud to count Henry and Kay as members of the American Academy. They will lead the conversation this afternoon and discuss their important work. Henry and Kay are joined today by two contributors to the volume. Tracey Meares is the Walton Hale Hamilton Professor and founding director of the Justice Collaboratory at Yale Law School, and author of the essay, Trust and Models of Policing, in the Daedalus volume. She was elected to the Academy in 2019. Lee Rainie is director of Internet and Technology Research at the Pew Research Center and contributed the essay, Networked Trust and the Future of Media. We're grateful to Tracey and Lee for joining us today. I encourage you to submit your questions for our distinguished panel throughout the event by using the Q&A feature found on the bottom of your Zoom screen. Following brief presentations, Kay will moderate a conversation among the panelists. It's now my pleasure to turn things over to our co-editor, Henry Brady.
Hi, everybody. It's good to be here. Today, we're going to talk about distrust in institutions, polarization and trust in institutions, and other issues. And I'm going to show you some data that comes from the essay that we had as part of our contribution to the volume. So why does it matter? Why do we care about whether people trust major institutions? Well, confidence and trust are essential to legitimacy and to make institutions work well. Without legitimacy, institutions have trouble working well. People don't trust them, and therefore they don't feel that they're trustworthy, and as a result are not necessarily willing to go along with the solutions they put forth to problems that we face. We know that confidence in governing institutions has fallen, and we know that confidence in governing institutions is politically polarized. That's not a surprise. Government is about different perspectives, and one might expect that confidence in governing institutions would be polarized based upon one's political perspective. But what about non-political institutions, such as business, churches, police, military, K-12 schools, television, and the press? What about them? What's happened over the last 50 years with respect to trust in them? We start from a big data set that my co-author, Thomas Kent, who's a graduate student at the University of California at Berkeley, and I put together. It's based upon melding three big data sets, Harris polls, general social surveys from 1972, Gallup polls from 1973. The questions are somewhat different, and we went to a lot of trouble to make sure that we can make the data as comparable as possible. In the end, we have 165,000 respondents, 128 surveys, and we have a scale that goes from 0 to 3 that we'll use throughout this presentation. It goes from hardly any confidence, 0, scored as 0, and number 3, a great deal of confidence. So here's an example of one of our slides from the paper, confidence in governmental institutions over time. What you see here is the confidence in your governmental institutions has gone down over time. Supreme Court, a bit, the presidency, a bit more, executive branch, even more, and finally Congress, most of all. Most of us probably know this, that confidence in Congress is exceptionally low. Let me just talk about two particular non-political institutions, confidence in police and the press over time. This is from 1973 to the present. We have some interruptions in the data series for police, unfortunately, and this is on our 3-point scale. And what we see is confidence in police has gone down a bit, and confidence in the press has declined precipitously. And in fact, if we look at all 20 institutions in our data, which pretty much span the gamut of various institutions one might want to think about in American politics, you find out that the four governmental institutions, the darker bars here, have had varying levels of decrease in trust. But the non-political institutions have also had significant declines in trust, ranging from Wall Street and TV news at one side to labor science on the other side. And most conspicuously, because trust is actually increased, is the military. I also put on this the press and police to show you that the two examples I showed you really sort of span the gamut of declines in trust in the last 50 years. The next slide shows you partisan confidence in the presidency over time. And what you find here is, and this is broken down by Democrats, Republicans, and independents. And what you find is that when a Republican president is in the presidency, Republicans are more trusting. And when there's a Democratic president in the presidency, Democrats are more trusting. That's not a big surprise. What you also find, however, is that there's real differences between the Democrats and Republicans over time in how much they trust or distrust the presidency. So on this picture where there's some bars overlaid, what the top bar does is it shows you that the peaks, which are typically the partisans of the party of the presidency, their sense of trust in the presidency, that hasn't changed much over time. So partisans of the current president have about as much trust today as they did 50 years ago. However, those who are not partisans of the president, the outgroup, if you will, their confidence in the presidency has declined substantially over time. And that's the bottom bar that just declines downwards. So there's another thing that's going on with respect to trust, and that is partisan confidence in institutions. Again, it's not surprising to see this for political institutions, but it is a little more surprising to see it for non-political institutions. So here's partisan confidence in the police over time. And what you find is that at the top, Republicans, if anything, their trust in the police has gone up somewhat, but trust on the part of Democrats has gone down over time. By the way, of course, Democrats are the party in which includes almost all African-American voters, and their trust has been especially low with respect to police. And Tracey's going to talk more about that and why that's so. How about the press? Well, we see, and this is the same scale, these two pictures. So as we go back and forth, we're looking at the same scale over time. And what we see is Democrats' confidence in the press stays high over time, but Republicans' confidence in the press has dropped over time really precipitously. So what we want to do is look at how much drop there has been or change there has been in polarization over time. So this first picture is plotting confidence of Democrats in various institutions in the 1970s versus confidence of Republicans in various institutions in that same time period. And if the two parties, the partisans of the two parties, agreed on their confidence in a particular institution, it would go along the solid line that's at about 45 degrees in the middle. However, if they disagree, then for the Democrats at the top of the picture, you'll have tendency in that direction. And you see for labor, for example, the Democrats trusted labor more than they did, than Republicans did in the 1970s. And the reverse is true with respect to business. But if you look at these dashed lines on the chart, which just shows you an area which is, there's just not much difference between the dashed lines and the solid line. So there's not much difference in trust between Democrats and Republicans. It's really only labor and business for which you see those differences. Now, let's see what happens in the 2010s. Suddenly, everything explodes outwards. And here, I've put circles around all of the ones that are outside the dashed lines now. And what you find is that almost every institution has either become more liked, having greater confidence on the part of Democrats or Republicans. And for the Democrats, it's what you might call the knowledge-producing institutions, press, news, public schools, education, higher education, and science. For the Republicans, it's the norm-enforcing and order-preserving institutions, religion, police, and the military. So quite an extraordinary change in who trusts which institution. So what have we found? Well, from among governing institutions, unsurprisingly given what we know, confidence in governing institutions has declined since the 70s. Confidence is now more polarized in governing institutions. That may not be so well known. But what's really conspicuous here is that for non-political institutions, trust has declined for every single one of them except the military, and confidence in all non-political institutions used to be polarized just between labor and business, the classic New Deal cleavage in American politics, but it's now polarized among essentially all institutions, with Republicans more confident in business, the military, police, and religion, and Democrats more confident in labor, the press, television, public schools, higher education, law, and science. So why is this so? Well, we don't know is probably the bottom line. We're beginning to know because we're beginning to study the phenomenon. But perhaps one third of the decline in trust is due to specific events. There's no question that bank failures, for example, cause banks to be less popular. Police behavior has an impact on the popularity of the police and confidence people have in it, and so on and so forth. So particular individual events might be part of the explanation. Perhaps one third of decline in trust is due to generalized distrust in institutions fueled by Watergate and other events. We know this because it's not only Democrats and Republicans who have decreased their confidence in institutions, it's independents as well. And for them, the explanation can't be partisan polarization, has to be something different. But then perhaps one third or more is due to increasing polarization along dimensions other than economic policy that separated business and labor. One speculation is the rise of social, cultural, and racial issues that now affect beliefs about politics and that are important second dimension, non-economic dimension of politics, that they're now affecting beliefs about institutions because these institutions are often involved with some of these issues. And then there's a selection of professionals into certain institutions. My colleague, Thomas Kent, has shown that in fact, there seems to have been a selection of more ideological Democrats into some institutions, precisely those institutions which are now less trusted by Republicans, and vice versa with respect to institutions that are now less trusted by Democrats. So there seems to be, in fact, a situation in which professionals now are either mostly Democrats or mostly Republicans in particular institutions, leading to perspectives on the part of people looking at those institutions that they're either trustworthy or not trustworthy, depending upon the individual's partisan perspective. So what does it mean? Well, on a 2019 survey, we asked respondents how they would feel about someone close to them choosing a career, and in a separate question, or marrying someone involved with various institutions. We were shocked and surprised to find that Republicans do not want their kin or friends to have close association with journalists or those in higher education, professors of all things. Democrats do not want close connections with those in the police, the military, or religious institutions. Indeed, Republicans are less willing to have their son or daughter or someone close to them get involved with a Democrat and a journalist than they are to have their son or daughter marry a gay person or an atheist. So journalists are less popular among Republicans than gay people or atheists. Finally, recent events suggest that distrusted institutions cannot be effective, and polarized trust leads to vastly different views on institutional performance and how we actually reform institutions if we feel we have to do that. Thank you. Now to Tracey Meares, who's going to talk about the police, trust in the police, and models of policing.
Good afternoon. My essay in the issue explores the concept of trust in policing by means of a puzzle. From the 1990s to the early 2000s, violent crime rates plummeted in the United States, and the secular trend continued downward for another decade, although the decline was not as steep. New York City became, as a city, one of the safest big cities in the world when measured by homicides per capita. There's many, many caveats to that statement, but consider the unit of measurement. It was during this period that police dedicated themselves to a program of proactive policing designed, by its terms, to attack violent crime. Think stop and frisk. And this approach led some scholars to hypothesize about the relative importance of police activity as a contributing factor to the decline. I don't want to explore that hypothesis here, although I have written about it. I'd rather explore the puzzle, which is this. Police understood themselves as warriors against crime and had a plausible story to tell about their effectiveness at that task. One might think, too, that public confidence in police and policing would be importantly related to police effectiveness at completing this task. But long-term polls, such as Gallup's, ones that Henry just explored, tell a different story. Gallup has tracked public confidence in a random sample of adults over a range of institutions, including police, for just over a quarter of a century. And during that time, confidence among Americans in police has remained largely flat, acknowledging Henry's pointing out that there's been a slight decline, still largely flat. Even when the numbers are disaggregated, there's not much change in the flatness. Among white respondents, the levels of those claiming to have a great deal or quite a lot of confidence in police ranged between 56% and 60% between 1993 and 2020. Among Black respondents, the levels are much, much lower, about half these numbers, until a larger dip to 19% in 2020. But again, with the exception of 2020, the numbers for Black respondents are still relatively flat, although low. The point here is that there seems to be very little relationship between police effectiveness at addressing violent crime, or at least the perception of it, and confidence in the institution. So how might we explain this disjuncture? The work I've done for the last 15 years focuses on the relationship between process-based fairness and legitimation of rational bureaucratic authority. Okay. This connection is deeply tied to trust through the concept of procedural justice. Procedural justice is a social psychological framework that helps us understand how people come to conclusions about the fairness of legal authorities, such as police. Research shows us that as a general matter, people care a lot more about how they are treated by authorities when coming to these conclusions, as opposed to the outcomes these authorities produce and whether those outcomes favor people specifically. One factor of procedural justice is whether a person perceives an authority such as a police officer, judge, or teacher to be trustworthy. Specifically, people want to believe that an authority with whom they are dealing can be trusted to treat them benevolently in the future. There are three other factors of procedural justice. These are, one, voice or an opportunity to have input in a decision, policy, or procedure. Two, indicators of fair decision-making, such as whether a decision is based in fact, transparent, and the decision-making is carried out in a neutral way without bias. Third, treatment with dignity and respect and concern for one's rights. Each and every one of the factors, the four factors I've mentioned, are important, and they occur together and lead to and reinforce perceptions of legitimacy of authority. Social psychologists tell us that the reason why people care about these four factors is that they're constantly looking for information about their value in society, both in terms of their value as individuals or the value of the group to which they belong. So, of course, what important representatives of the state, such as police, have to say, gives people critical signal on this subject. The stakes are high. Research shows that when people perceive authorities to be legitimate, they're much more likely to engage and cooperate with them and also follow directives voluntarily. In the essay, I review research evaluating different policies that police agencies have adopted and some of the behavioral outcomes of training based on these policies. The research base is small, but it's promising. In one notable study published by Wood and colleagues in Science, procedural justice training led to reduced complaints against police officers and reduced reports of use of force. Still, though, most measured changes that we have detected are small, and this is likely because of the goal rather than the conceptual framework. It's important to understand that taking the conceptual framework that I've offered here can do so much more than simply make the existing model of policing we have a little less harmful. Rather, it could and should lead to rethinking how state actors are used and deployed to address problems of safety deprivation, to borrow a term by my colleague Vesla Weaver, such as violence. One approach I offer in the essay is that it's incredibly important to rethink the very laws that the police enforce, especially low-level ordinances such as jaywalking, selling loose cigarettes on a street corner, or limitations on the height of grass lawns. In many cities, these laws are enforced by emergency responders with guns. Now, we could think about approving policing by addressing such enforcement through procedural justice strategies, but another more important and, in my mind, democratically legitimate approach is to prohibit forcible arrest for such offenses altogether legislatively. Eric Garner lost his life for selling loose cigarettes on a street corner. Enforcement of such laws ends up making communities that suffer from the symptoms of safety deprivation, such as violence, unable to rely on and trust the state that they deserve to have protect them as citizens. So now I'd like to turn it over to Lee, and then I look forward to your questions.
Thanks so much, Tracey. I'm delighted to be here and looking forward to our conversation together. In the essay that I wrote for this issue, I talked about the collapse of the civic information system as measured by trust in news media and social media, but also just a palpable sense of the American public in particular, that they are not getting the information they need. They are not necessarily convinced that they are being told the truth about what's going on. And they are mightily confused about how to sort their way through the new structures that have developed in the civic information system. Some of the problems, of course, related to this are tied to the business problems that newspapers in particular are having in the United States. There have been more than 2,100 newspapers lost since 2004 in the United States, many more have merged to become parts of larger ownership issues. And some have moved from being daily papers to weekly newspapers. The rise of these news deserts has been dramatically illustrated by the analysis by Penelope Muse Abernathy at UNC, And the biggest problem that comes from this, not only is just the communities themselves not getting the kind of accountability journalism that they are expecting, but newspapers are a particularly important part of the information ecosystem in communities. A bunch of studies that we've done at the Pew Research Center and that have been done at the Federal Communications Commission have documented how newspapers are essentially the feeder system of civic information for all other kinds of actors in civic information systems. They set the agenda for television coverage in many ways. They set the agenda for groups that are acting in those communities. And so the loss of newspapers and the original reporting that often originates in newspapers is a particular loss. Newsrooms are going through another set of losses in this current period, but between 2008 and 2020, almost 30,000 news jobs were lost in the country. And again, the toll on what happens in newsrooms, what newsrooms are able to produce is staggering in these things. One of the striking things, as Henry pointed out in his modeling, was that there has now become a sort of polarized sense of particularly the role of national news organizations in the information ecosystem. Democrats have maintained a relatively high level of confidence, according to our data at Pew Research, on this, but the collapse of Republican confidence in national news organizations is particularly striking. Local news organizations haven't seen quite the same dramatic results, but social media is also seen a sort of polarizing force. I assume if we were measuring, if there were measures of talk radio, the sort of opposite trend would be noticed, where Republicans were gaining confidence, even as Democrats, of course, were losing confidence. A striking thing, of course, that's happened during this period is, even as people are saying they are less trusting of news organizations in general in the newspaper and television business, there has been a partisan sorting of audiences among publications and news operations, so that there are plenty of ways that people can talk about how they do trust certain news outlets, that they have confidence that these outlets are delivering in appropriate ways to the news ecosystems of their communities. These are data where we have run people through a battery of about 30 news organizations and asked people which they first trust and which they don't trust. And you'll see particularly that the liberal audiences of some news organizations are greatly at variance with the conservative audiences of other news organizations. So there's a way in which the broad story about the declining trust in news organizations is really a story about how people are migrating to different kinds of sources for different kinds of purposes, particularly related to partisan purposes when it comes to sort of large-scale news organizations. When it comes to social media, of course, it's not a single one-size-fits-all phenomenon. There are ways in which different platforms serve different purposes to people. But on this, again, this broad measures of trust and distrust for social media platforms, you can see that the social media as a whole is not necessarily well thought of, and in the broad sense of things, delivering the kind of information that people need. At the same time, of course, they customize their filters, they organize their news feeds, they structure their friendship groups to give them the information that they want. So there are plenty of reasons why people still think that social media is a valuable news source to them and relevant to them and relatively trustworthy. But as a whole, the social media sphere has a very little confidence of the broad public. One of the core arguments I make in my article is that there are certain properties of digital media now that have come into place that have sort of changed media spaces and media audiences in particular ways that affect trust. In digital media is pervasive, portable, persistent, invisible, personal and customizable, participatory, enabling creation by so many more actors in the political ecosystem. It's replicable, so it can be spread quite widely and in viral sense. And most dramatically, it's searchable, so that even stuff as in the explosion of information that's growing in the Democratic discourse, it's relatively easy to find it thanks to powerful search tools. Of course, a new organizing factor to lots of information in this system is the algorithmic way in which certain kinds of information is elevated. This is material that we gathered at the Pew Research Center from the social media posts of public officials, members of Congress. And we found that the more indignant the language was in a post, the more likes it got, the more comments it got, the more shares it got, which are the metrics that social media companies use to measure engagement and decide what kind, how to tweak their algorithms to deliver certain kinds of material to certain kinds of people. Of course, there's a tremendous amount of concern for arising in 2016, but continuing on since then, about the ways in which social media algorithms also sort of radicalize the content that people are exposed to as they go ever more deeply into rabbit holes of recommended videos, recommended posts, and things like that. The result of this, of course, is that Americans are actually are uniformly in agreement that it's hard for partisans, most Republicans and Democratic voters, to agree on certain facts. It used to be, when we measured this, that the majority of people were saying that they can agree on certain facts, but they can't agree on policies. Now it's just that they don't even have the same shared factual universe and even moral universe if you're adding in the effective polarization that's going on here. Just like Harry has pointed out, Americans are sure that this is leading to lower confidence in government. 54% think that it also affects social trust. So there are interesting interplay between institutional trust and social trust. And they also say that a majority say that it's makes it hard for political leaders to get the work done. And they agree that there are big problems of the kind that Henry described at the beginning. There's a vast agreement that both trust in the federal government and social trust has been shrinking over the past generation. It's an important problem to solve, and that it's getting in the way of solving problems. At the end of the piece, I talk about a couple of reforms that are particularly talked about in digital spaces. The Internet Bill of Rights, particularly related to privacy, people's control of their own data and control of their own experiences online is one major element of that. Changes in algorithms that maybe downplay the kind of engagement I just described and offer privilege accurate sources or known to be accurate sources, diverse perspectives, and encourage discourse that is at least inclined a little bit more than now to agreement. There's a ton of transparency argumentation going on in how this looks, and particularly when it relates to the algorithmic black boxes that deliver so much information to people through social media systems. There's a call for the online spaces to enjoy the kind of sort of public support, public broadcasting spaces that were created when Newton Minow finally convinced the public that the regular commercial networks of the 1950s and 60s were a commercial wasteland. And there's a standard calls for more civic and digital literacy to be passed along to people. That's the end of my material, and I'm happy to turn it over to Kay.
Thank you, Henry, Tracy, and Lee. You've convinced me as if I needed to be convinced that lack of trust is a really important phenomenon for our institutions and our society and our government to work well. But for us to trust institutions, they need to be trustworthy. So I want to start by asking you, if each of you could make a change in the institution you talk about to make it more trustworthy, what would you do? You want to start, Lee? Because you actually put some stuff up.
Yeah. There are ways in which now trust is a contingent and fractal kind of social exchange between people. So it's not as if people are making big binary judgments about whether they trust an institution or not. It's transactional and in the moment. So part of the story with journalism is to follow the playbook that Kay, you and Henry and Sidney Verba have given all of us about voice itself. Some of the most interesting experiments that have tried to test how journalism can become more trustworthy relate to how it can become more fair and to the vote, particularly to the voices that are not often heard in the culture, and how it can be more more oriented towards sort of social criticism of a constructive kind, giving voice again to the populations that haven't necessarily, or that don't necessarily have a voice in political institutions. The other thing that a lot of people talk about, of course, is changing the narrative style of journalism itself, having it be less one-siderism or both-siderism and having it less hue to sort of telling all sides of a story and being straightforward about it. It's making sure that the essential context and truthfulness of facts is honored in the narrative itself.
How about you, Tracey? You have a response for the police?
Yeah, I've already offered a couple in my talk, but let me just emphasize something, which is to say, for policing, actually taking seriously the concept of trust itself is a major change. And that was the work that I did with Tom Tyler over the years that, I think found its sort of highest encapsulation in the President's Task Force report, 21st Century Policing, the idea that the job of the police was actually to think about encouraging trust, a more trusting relationship between police as servants of the communities rather than as warriors against crime. So then what does that mean? There are lots of different things you can do, as I mentioned, taking the job as it's currently considered, for slight improvements. But I do think that once you make trust central and center it, you understand that the job itself has to be fundamentally different, that it's really difficult to take armed emergency responders that are deployed for a huge whole range of problems in primarily disadvantaged communities and think that that's going to fundamentally change that trusting relationship. It's not. It's why a lot of people talk about reducing the footprint, certainly, of armed emergency responders. I think the task actually is to think importantly differently about how the state thinks about helping communities promote safety. That doesn't mean that the state shouldn't be involved at all. In fact, I think it's critical. Citizens actually deserve state support for their goals and projects of safety. But it does mean that, the idea that we're going to address these problems by sending people with guns to every single problem is just a fundamentally bad idea, and we shouldn't do it.
Henry, do you want to respond to anything that either Tracey or Lee said, or chime in about any of the institutions in your more global consideration of this issue?
Yeah, let me just say that the literature says there's four ways to create trust in institutions. One is for a governmental institution just to bestow its regulatory trust on other institutions. It's not clear that's a very good strategy these days because government's got its own trust problem. A second way is for cultural norms to be met by institutions. And that's part of what we face right now is that some people think that some institutions are not really recognizing the cultural norms that should be recognized. And Tracey, I think, talks to that with respect to police. Another one, of course, is a third way is to be ethical and to adhere to the normative standards of a society. And many institutions fail on that account with scandals and all sorts of other problems. And the final one is institutions actually have to perform. And it seems to me that's one route that is fairly neutral and doesn't require a wholesale change in our society, but it does require the government and these institutions work better than they have in the past. And so that, speaking as a former public policy dean, that's where we have to put a lot of effort.
Let me ask all of you, since institutional performance is imperfect, and Henry just elaborated on that, institutions need to be accountable, which of course implies that sometimes naive trust may have its own dangers. What's the sweet spot on the continuum between skepticism and trust that works well? Lee, you want to have, for your institution, you want to lead off on that?
Sure. Being factual is the starting place for lots of things related to that. If you want to organize for the distribution of public goods, the sort of starting place or the presumption of trust is something that Americans are pretty comfortable with or have been until relatively recently. That's the big change we're going through now. And it's, I think the problem that most Americans see now is that the accountability piece is emphasized, the social critique is emphasized, the masters of sowing doubt have got a playbook that is getting better almost day by day. And so the forces against which trust builders are fighting seem more organized and more potent than they might have been in days gone by. My favorite term of the era is Robert Proctor's term from, he's a historian at Stanford, who talks about agnotology, and the science of sowing doubt now is a well-practiced science.
Tracey, do you have something to add?
I have to admit, I have a little trouble getting my head around the concept of sweet spot, given the kinds of things that I study. And how I think a commitment to process-based legitimation might help improve trust in policing. One thing I think I can say is that to the extent that that idea it implies something that's more transactional and focusing on back-end accountability, that is, you trust police to do certain things and then they harm you. And then people point to, too many instances that, we've seen on social media, instances of police doing horrific things to people, or even, quite ordinary kinds of things in terms of just being less civil and less polite. Jennifer Eberhardt at Stanford has wonderful research showing that it's not so much that police are actually more rude to Black people as opposed to white people. They're simply less polite. And she's got an amazing paper with colleagues. I think the paper's headed up by Nick Camp, showing that you can even identify this in the tone of how police speak to people, prosody, without actually using words. It's really stunning research. In any case, maybe one way of understanding the sweet spot is to think about accountability differently. So another colleague of mine in the law, Barry Friedman, and his co-author, Maria Ponomarenko, write about the difference between front-end accountability and back-end accountability. So lots of times in this world of thinking about police excess, we think about holding particular police officers or particular agencies accountable for wrongful things they have done. Definitely important. But I think more critical to, the process of reform, transformation, change, choose your term, is to imagine different institutions for articulating the goals and projects of what police do, or we'll call them, state actors devoted to safety, what they do in the first place, right? And there are very few mechanisms, actually, that take that seriously. I explore a couple in the essay, but we need much more of that. So not so much civilian review boards, which is a kind of after-the-fact review of what individual police officers do, but civilian policy boards that actually channel what communities want these agents to do for them.
Henry, do you want to chime in on any way?
Just quickly, there's a great essay, I think, in our Daedalus volume on trust in the military, which actually asks this very question, is that, as I showed, that's the one institution where trust is increased, and the authors ask, well, is that a good thing or is that a bad thing? And shouldn't we be somewhat skeptical about the military and about all institutions? The final thing I'd say is that it's a hard thing to know exactly what the sweet spot is for trust. However, it is probably pretty clear that it's problematic when we have polarization in trust. That means there's just tremendous disagreement in a society about what institutions to trust and what institutions not to trust. And that makes it very hard for those institutions to work with those people who distrust them especially when the people who trust them say, for example, take the police, people who trust them say, well, we should just put a lot more money into the model that we've had historically because it's worked so well. And the people who distrust the police say, no, it really hasn't worked well at all. And so that's really, I think, one of the fundamental problems we face, regardless of how we feel about the sweet spot for trust.
Which might just be another way of saying what that different groups of people want these institutions to do different things, right? Yeah. Right.
But nevertheless, they have to square that circle because those institutions are responsible for serving everybody and they got to figure out a way to do it. I think your notion of trying to focus more on procedural justice and on trust instead of just how many people have you put in jail is a very, very, very good one.
Let me, before we turn to the audience questions, ask one more question that's somewhat different. Students of Congress sometimes talk about Fennow's paradox, the fact that many people disapprove of Congress, but love their own member of Congress. Similarly, Americans are skeptical about American medicine in general and are enthusiastic about their doctors. Is there an analog to Fennow's paradox in your realm, Tracey, or your realm, Lee?
Sure. I mean, you know, you'll hear lots of stories where people, in the very communities where the relationship between police as a general matter and the members of the neighborhoods that they're policing is considered to be poor at best. You know, many people in those communities can tell you about, you know, the one police officer that they like or even love, often referred to in nostalgic terms. But, you know, I my guess is it's not the same kind of phenomenon that you're talking about with respect to, you know, a congressman. It's not sort of New Haven police are the best, but everybody else is bad. It's more like my neighbor over there is a cop. And, you know, all the other cops are corrupt, something like that.
Thank you. Lee, you got something to say?
The press version of this is sort of closer to Fennow's original idea, which is Americans can very well articulate which local news personalities, which columnists they like a lot. But the institution is what they're judging. And what Fennow's great insight was that so many members of Congress get elected because they run against the institution that they end up serving in. The other thing that the modern era has taught us is familiarity breeds empathy. The more we know about each other's lives and the more we have a sense that the person on the other end of the screen or the other end of the stethoscope is you know, on our side, the more willing we are to invest trust in them.
Let's move now to hearing from the audience. And one issue that came up in a couple of different ways is, do any of you know anything about trust in institutions in other rich democracies that we might compare ourselves to, and how they cultivate trust, or are other rich democracies facing the same issues with regard to trust that the U.S. is? I'm seeing some nods. So Henry, do you want to start?
Well, just briefly, the other countries are facing similar kinds of problems. There's no question that there's declines in trust in other nations, and there's also some polarization in trust. And this seems to be linked with the rise of populism and basic more authoritarian impulses, rise of the importance of certain kinds of issues and so forth. So yes, similar things. I don't know that much about how other nations are trying to increase trust in their institutions. I will say one thing that works for America is that it turns out that national institutions are typically less trusted than state institutions, which are less trusted than local institutions. And that gets back to Lee's comment about localism. And so part of what we have to do is maybe think about policies that we implement, that we make globally, but we implement locally, and we figure out ways that can be a face on that institution, probably made accountable nationally, but nevertheless is a local institution so that people will trust it.
Tracey, you...
So My research doesn't focus really on levels of trust and the like in other countries. But one thing I can say is that the concept of a procedural justice and tied to legitimacy that I explained is robust outside of the United States and has been studied all over the world. And it's, you know, basically all groups here have pretty much the same view. And it's also true, certainly, in Europe. And I think that the places where the research is sort of the most spotty is places like China, which is not surprising, I guess. In terms of what people have tried, I personally have done work with Birmingham, England, on their police force. It's the second largest city there. I was going to say they're Chicago, but Chicago is no longer second city here. And in any case, they have made a really concerted effort to, you know, to take this approach seriously all the way, not only through thinking about how officers treat people on the street, but even more importantly, thinking about the implications of this approach for how the institution is itself is organized, because it's really difficult for officers to treat people on the street with procedural justice when their own managers and supervisors don't treat them that way.
It's not so much a trust issue, but the one example of American exceptionalism is on social media and a good feeling about it. Many other places, a majority of residents, both in developed and in developing nations, think social media is a net good for society. They like the empowerment that it provides to people. They like that it's a sidestepping around institutions that don't give them the voice and don't tell the stories that they want told. The other thing that I would kind of call Fennow's corollary is that, you know, people are quite confident in their own capacity to make judgments about the things that are trustworthy, are worth paying attention to, but they also think that their societies at large are struggling with these issues. So it's sort of an "I'm okay, everybody else is screwed up" kind of dynamic, where it also speaks to the problems that kind of Tracey was alluding to of how you build trust in an environment where people think they can navigate the ecosystem relatively well, but everyone else is a mess in the midst of it.
There's a question that came up that interested me that I think really goes to Lee, which is, how does reality TV feed into some of the things that you've been talking about?
Yeah, it's a companion phenomenon. I think the sense that people are voyeurs and that there's a sort of almost panopticon feeling to all of this. I mean, Henry made a strong mention, I think appropriately, of inequality as one of the other factors that is driving a lot of this above and beyond, or in addition to polarization. The tech story that's part of this is people having a sense that their lives are, they are less control of their lives. They're less control of their data. They're less in control of the way that they're being steered and profiled by things like that. And so there's a strong sense that people are struggling to make meaning out of a world where they don't have a sense of what's going on behind the curtain in their lives.
There's a question that probably goes to Henry, but it can go to everybody on the screen. It's a little more technical, and it's from our colleagues. Are people really answering surveys these days? And can we trust these longitudinal data that show changes?
I think we can trust them. I think this is a big problem for survey research that we're facing. And Lee and I, frankly, probably could spend hours telling you about our concerns about this. But I do believe that given the nature of these polls and the cross-checks that we have, that I'm pretty sure that they're measuring something real and that we can be confident in them. I don't really want to get a lot more into it than that. It just, there is a big problem we face. Part of the problem is very as simple as we don't know how to get a good sample, representative sample of Americans from the web. And the web is where more and more people now are doing most of their work and interacting. Telephone surveys don't work the way they once did. And in-person surveys are ridiculously expensive. So we just don't have some of the tools that we had in the past. By the way, I also see that somebody has asked questions about whether or not the Defense Authorization Act should be considered here, which apparently has some things in it about trying to create a program for civic education. And the thing I like best about the five things listed is the ability of participants to collaborate and compromise with others to solve problems. Civics education in America is focused too much on what's the Constitution, what are the laws, not enough on teaching people that when you got a problem, everybody's got to get in a room together and there will be compromise. And one of the problems we face in America today, and we saw it recently with the choice of our speaker for the House of Representatives, is that there are people who simply think compromise is a dirty word and it's just not something that should be done. And if that's where we are, then it's going to be hard to get anything done.
A question came for you, Tracey, that relates to something that's just been in front of us, which is sort of civic education and the like. How you think the schools fit into trust in police or lack of trust into police, and especially the middle schools, the questioner raised.
So I think I have three answers. The idea of legal socialization is actually really important to the ideas about procedural justice that I spoke about earlier. In fact, what Henry was talking about, you know, the mechanisms that we use to teach kids how to solve problems is actually related to, you know, these ideas of process-based legitimation, especially when you think about how the fact that a child's teacher is actually the first authority figure that the child interacts with outside of her parents, right? And there's really fascinating research by a psychologist named Rick Trinkner showing a relationship between parenting styles and one's relationship with teachers and a kid's relationship with teachers and a kid's relationship with police officers. I don't do developmental psychology, so I can't say much about what's going on in middle schools. My research center, the Justice Collaboratory, has done some work on the relationship that high schoolers have with SROs, school research officers, resource officers. That work is done by Tom Tyler and, oh my gosh, you're going to kill me. I cannot remember her name right now at the moment. I'll see if I can put it in the chat. But it's on our website. The last thing I'll say about this is that I think it's incredibly important to think about the idea of legal socialization as in a broader way than just schooling. So a co-author and I, Ben Justice, have a paper in the Annals of Social and Political Science called How the Criminal Justice System Educates Citizens. And so I would say outside of public schools, the criminal justice system is one of the primary mechanisms that people learn about their status and identity as citizens. It's really important to take that seriously. And we explore that idea in the essay.
Thank you. There's a question, and forgive me because I'm going to read it. It goes to you, Henry, and I want to get it right. I can't summarize it easily. Henry, your findings that distrust appears to have spread from specifically political to social and economic institutions apparently related to polarization. Does this mean that our whole society has become increasingly politicized? And might it be possible to depoliticize reactions to social and economic institutions as part of the solution?
Yeah, I think it does mean that we've gotten a lot more politicization of institutions that didn't used to be politicized. I think that's a worry. It may be a sign in that we're finally confronting some problems as well, so that it's not necessarily all bad. But perhaps the most important thing to do is to say that institutions have to be responsible for thinking about how they create trust in the communities that they serve. I know that while I was dean here at Berkeley, we worked really, really hard to make sure that we had an institution that allowed for free speech, even to the extent of spending literally millions of dollars. So Milo Yiannopoulos, who is a conservative right-wing troublemaker, I don't think there's any way to describe him except that, to give him a forum so that he could speak. Sadly, unfortunately, that doesn't necessarily get covered in the way it should have, because there's still this remaining notion that somehow Berkeley is not really supporting free speech, when in fact we have spent millions and done extraordinary things to support it. So somehow the word's not getting out. But the first instance, institutions have to be responsible for thinking, as Tracey said, that trust is one of the things they have to be making sure that they create in the minds of the people who they are serving, and that's their first and foremost job.
The other dimension of this I just wanted to add is though that the actors in the system who want to politicize so much more are just truly adept at finding ways to bring these culture wars kinds of things into institutions that were escaped them for a long time. I mean, you look at local school boards now are becoming battlegrounds. Pew data a couple of years ago was shocking in pointing out that public confidence, I should say Republican confidence in colleges and universities, had plummeted as when they were asked about their impact on society. So in a way, Henry's right, it's worth striving for, but you can just see the dynamic pushing in the other direction. There are so many provocateurs in the system and so many folks who just want to bring these sensibilities and these values, these are moral questions too, to dimensions of society that have not had them before.
To follow up on your comment, Lee, which is interesting, to what extent does the fact that the media are sort of paid to cover that which is newsworthy and, not that which is boring or mainstream contribute to that?
And Americans are just in distress about that, too. No matter where they sit on the partisan spectrum, they think that there's too much sensationalism. There's too much commercialization of storytelling. And they are just begging to be told different kinds of stories with different narratives about people solving problems and about communities coming together, and particularly at the local level, about people from different perspectives finding ways to solve problems and essentially become models for state and particularly national politics.
Right, but there aren't local newspapers. I mean, that they want it, but it's not there. I mean, I actually was so distressed a couple of years ago about the state of national media that I actually stopped reading the New York Times because I just couldn't take it anymore. I started reading the New Haven Independent every day, which is a wonderful online local paper with detailed stories about what's going on in my city and the kind of problem solving that you mentioned. I think too many people just don't have access to that. And while I have the floor, the paper is by Yael Grunow at Smith College and Tom Tyler. So sorry about that, Yael.
A different question came up, and it may call for some speculation, which is, on the one hand, what we've been talking about involves a lot about political parties and polarization, but we haven't heard anything about the trajectory of trust in parties or the extent to which trust in parties is an important piece of democratic institutions that we need to trust. Henry, you got anything to say about that?
Yeah, there's really not much data on that. Maybe Lee has some data because he's got such a treasure trove at Pew. I just don't know. Lee? Mm-hmm.
What you pick up in between the lines and the way people are answering these questions is that people are cobbling together partisan belief systems, moral belief systems, spiritual belief systems in many ways, and that it's a smorgasbord. And so they're not, the rise of independence is one of the simple ways that all of us try to measure this. But when you probe independence, in many cases, they've got partisan affiliations that they pretty much like and are, act like Republicans or Democrats. They just don't want to say so. But there are ways in which now Again, there's this Lego style way in which people are assembling their lives in all dimensions of cognition, as well as the way they're acting in the world.
There's a variation on this theme. And again, I'm going to read. What, if anything, can non-political institutions, and Henry talked about non-political institutions as opposed to governing ones, do to regain the confidence of people who see them as pursuing distasteful political goals? Should, for example, journalists or professors change the way they do business in the hopes of mollifying conservative critics?
Well, I think they should be, as I said, here at the university, we're very clear on the fact that we are an important American public institution and that we have to behave in ways that model correct behavior. So we have worked hard to protect free speech. I don't think we get as much credit for it as we should. And that's part of the problem, is that there are all these provocateurs out there who want to take any incident and describe it in a way that is most injurious to the institution that they really are trying to harm. And so that's why somebody like Milo Yiannopoulos, even though he got every bit of chance that he could possibly have to have an event here, which, by the way, in the end, essentially nobody showed up for it. Nevertheless, that's coded by the right-wing media as if somehow that was a failure at Berkeley, when it wasn't at all. It was a failure of Milo Yiannopoulos. So that's part of the problem we have, is this provocateurs. I sort of think, and I think Lee refers to this at the end of his essay, we're in a period like when Gutenberg first invented printing, and when right after the French Revolution, where everything seems up for grabs in terms of the media and the culture and the society. And we're going to have to work hard to find a new equilibrium. And maybe it's worth reading about those periods to see what happened when suddenly everybody could print a book with all sorts of nonsense in it, or perhaps wisdom in it, and how that worked out to a point where we got things like editorial boards for presses, and we got newspapers that had editorial boards, and so on and so forth. We just need new mechanisms. And we see this most clearly with respect to the internet, where we just still do not have the mechanisms we need to somehow make sure that people understand what's nonsense and what's worthwhile on it on the internet.
Tracey,
this is Tracey Meares' own personal opinion. This is not my research. I mean, the idea that I would change how I did my job when, you know, my approach is actually to make sure that my students understand concepts and facts. No, I'm not going to change that. But what it does make me thinking about all of the presentations we've heard today, is how we get back to a world, if possible, where people can agree on a certain set of facts and then disagree on policies. And in a world that we can't even agree on facts, it's really hard to know how we're going to get there. This business model point, I think, is critical, which is why I stopped reading the New York Times, and the ways in which the headlines were sort of committed to, and some of the stories were committed to both sidesism. Again, my own personal opinion. But when, you know, certain partisans don't trust, you know, public broadcasting and, you know, public models of information provision that we all pay for, it's really dispiriting.
There are a couple of essays in the issue that are just marvelous on science and trust in science.
Yeah.
And they almost uniformly make the point that engagement has to occur. Scientists for a long time thought that public engagement was sort of too messy or too apart from the main role of gathering and organizing the evidence that they were gathering. And I think there's a powerful argument in a couple of essays that engagement is the starting point on this. And it's engagement with humility, that you know, people have their own stories, their own experiences, their own ways of understanding things, and that, you know, sort of yelling at them about what's a fact and what's not, and what's to be believed and what's not, didn't work during COVID for many people. It didn't close the deal with people who started or went to skeptical points of view. So again, that's a little bit of an add-on to your question, Kay.
It leads into what will be my final question to everyone. There's a question that was asked, and it was asked in a very partisan way. And I'm a political scientist, and I teach politics, and so I try to make these things not partisan. Let me say that the data that we've seen end in 2019, 2020, 2021, and we've been in an era with some unprecedented developments, both with regard to elections, as well as you were just talking about a pandemic and so on. So my question to all of you is, how do you think the really, almost unprecedented developments of the last couple of years affect the issues we've been talking about today? Silence.
I'll give the simple Pew answer on this. I think they have fundamentally changed the way people approach information and evidence about the society around them. I think they are wrapped in partisan wrappers now in ways that they didn't used to be. There's a sort of resorting to sort of the standard actors and their explanations, or people don't live in echo chambers. There are a lot of liberals who listen to conservative talk radio, and there are a lot of conservatives who watch liberal media. They don't do it to get a separate point of view so much as how to figure out what the enemy's up to and how to find out the best arguments against that. And so I don't know. I think it's an inevitable way now that this stuff creeps into more dimensions of life, that more things get evaluated the way, the many authors in this issue talk about.
What I'll offer is that in light of what Lee just said, the problems that we need to solve are more difficult and more difficult to solve than they've ever been. And, the approach that I've thought about actually takes a page from something that Henry said earlier, which is you have to be very local. It turns out that policing is naturally that way. It's harder actually to make arguments about national level interventions in policing than it is in, say, schooling and education. And so I think there's a way in which that can be a strength for this approach, given the comments and conversations we've had about the way trust is built from the bottom up and locally. And that's the approach that we've taken.
Henry, you want to?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's important to remember that the trends that we show are 50 years in the making by the data we have. I think they've been exacerbated recently, but they're a little deeper than just even the internet, for example, although I'm happy to blame the internet because I do think the business model there that, as Lee's data show, that focuses on indignation and being angry is really one that's created division among us, and that we have to find ways to get beyond that. But I think the problems we face really require very fundamental thinking about things like, how do we reinvigorate democracy? And I'll give a plug here for another American Academy study, Our Common Purpose, which I actually think has a lot of great ideas about how to think about making things better. One of those things they talk about, by the way, is reinvigorating local media. We just have to make sure that we don't have the demise of all these local newspapers. For the simple reason, by the way, for those who don't care about much else, that corruption is going to increase in those local governments. Without anybody to watch them, it's just going to have to be the case that we're going to have a lot of places like Bell, California. And if you don't know about Bell, California, look it up. It's a really great story about how some people who were unwatched basically built the city out of hundreds of thousands and maybe even millions of dollars because nobody was there to watch what they were doing. We need local media, and we need it very, very badly. And we have to think of a model. And by the way, local media has been destroyed by the internet, partly because all of the revenue sources were taken away, classifieds and the advertising from stores and so forth. And the net result is they just don't have the financial wherewithal that they used to have. So we got to find a way to get money to those institutions. And that's probably going to be taxing maybe the internet and then sending it to those local papers. And so they can create the content that's so vitally important to our news system ecosystem.
Well, thank you very much to all of you, to Lee, to Tracey, to Henry, and I leave it for the final word to David Oxtoby.
Thank you. We are out of time, but I hope you've enjoyed this very spirited discussion as much as I have. Let me thank Henry and Kay for their leadership of the Daedalus volume, Tracey and Lee for their contributions to this issue, all of them for their very thoughtful comments today. And thank you to the whole audience for being here, a very important issue to discuss. The Daedalus issue on institutions, experts, and the loss of trust is available open access, along with decades of volumes on our website. I hope you will continue to engage with this work and share the essays in the Daedalus issue with colleagues, friends, and students. This concludes the 2110th Stated Meeting of the American Academy. Have a good evening.